welcome you to the start of a new series called Fortress, Finding Refuge in the Arms of Love. I ain't talking about your man. I ain't talking about your lady. I know she hugs you right and he's strong. That's good. You need that. But we're talking about finding refuge, finding shelter, finding protection, finding fortress. And the one who loves us above all others, the one who loves us in the right way, in the perfect way, that's finding refuge in the arms of God. So this is going to be a good series, people. The series is about God's protection over our lives. And today, my prayer that by the time we leave here, that we will all see it. That's the whole purpose of my sermon today. Not that you would just know it because they told you, but today I'm praying that we would have a revelation, that we would see it. Also, this is awesome. We're gonna have a lot of speakers throughout this series. So I'm gonna open up and then we got some awesome people. We got some big TDP favorites coming to you guys and they're ready. This series is gonna be great. And what's so cool, we're giving everyone an opportunity to preach, right? That's good. You guys are gonna preach today too. Yeah, some of you said, what? Yeah. We're gonna preach today. We're gonna preach this together, amen? And we're gonna see that God indeed is our fortress. When you came in through the doors, you should have received the series note card, amen? You guys got your series note cards? Wave them at me, wave them at me. Now, if you don't have one, now just raise your hand above those waved note cards so that you can get one. Our first impressions team, look for those people that are waving their hands that they need a series note card. Make sure you get them a pen. And it also should come with a theme verse. So let's read that together. This is our theme verse for the series. It comes from Psalm 18, verse 2. You'll see it at the bottom of below that verse. And let's read this together, okay? I'm gonna count to three so we can all start together. You guys ready? You got your series note card? Ready? One, two, three. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock, in whom I take refuge, my shield, and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. Amen, let's give it up. So take this card, put it somewhere that you're gonna be able to see this so that you have confidence that God is your fortress, amen. Psalmist David wrote this. He faced many wars, many battles, and he wrote these words because in the midst of the battles that he faced, the struggles, the weaknesses, God was still surrounding him with a fortress, amen? And so that's what we're proclaiming over you, and that's what I want you to see today, that he already is a fortress. He's already surrounded you. He's already protected you, amen? So how many people are ready to get into God's word? Amen. If you can open up your Bibles or your apps, we're that modern now that preachers can say, open up your Bibles or your apps. To 2 Kings chapter 6. Just a couple of verses, so if you got strength in your legs, I'll encourage you to stand up for the reading of God's word. We stand for everything these days. Let's stand for his word, amen? 2 Kings chapter 6. We're going to begin at verse 15. Going to the Old Testament. I want to give you a little bit of context before I read this so we're not lost. We're focusing in on a passage of scripture where the prophet Elisha, with a S-H-A, not Elijah, where the prophet Elisha, who's actually the successor prophet of the prophet that most of us are familiar with, Elijah, the J-A-H, this is Elisha. The Lord revealed to Elijah that Elisha would be that next prophet, that next main prophet that would carry Israel, the nation. And so we're reading about Elisha here and some little context. The enemy army of Israel at the time is trying to overthrow Israel. And the king of the enemy army, what he did was he actually set out his army, his forces, his troops. He tried to plant them and position them in places where the nation of Israel couldn't see them, so that when they could kind of almost walk into them and kind of overtake them. And so his plan was to set them up, and he was setting them up in all these places. But the prophet Elisha was able to see the plans of this enemy king. And so what he would do is he would go back to the king of Israel. He'd be like, don't go that way. Your enemy has set up troops in that place. He's waiting for you. So what the king of Israel, he would do, he would reroute his people. And so the enemy king got so frustrated. He went back to his officials. He said, which one of you are spies, basically? You guys keep, one of you are going back and telling the Israel king what we're doing and where we're at. Because he keeps avoiding us. He keeps taking a different route. Which one of you guys are spies? Which one of you are working for the king of Israel? And his officers tell him, say, ain't none of us working for him. But they got a prophet, Elisha. And the Lord reveals to him, and he's the one ratting us out. And so the king makes a plan. He says, you know what? His ultimate goal is to destroy Israel. But he realizes that he can't do that with the man of God, Elisha, the prophet, on their side. So he says, this is what we got to do. Rather than going for Israel, which Elisha is going to be able to tell them, he makes a plan. He says, let's go for Elisha first. Let's do that. And if we could take him out, then we could take out the nation of Israel. So that's kind of the context of this story. I'll give you a little bit more when we get into this. But beginning at verse 15, it says, when the servant of the man of God got up, so Elisha's not alone, he's got a servant with him. This guy's just caught in the crossfire. Poor guy, poor servant. When the servant of the man of God, referring to Elisha, got up and went out early the next morning, an army with horses and chariots had surrounded the city. That's the enemy army. They have now surrounded the city where Elisha is at with his servant. Poor old servant. Look at this. Oh no, my Lord. What shall we do? The servant asked. He's in trouble. What are we gonna do? The city is surrounded by enemy forces. He said, oh no. How many of you guys woke up in the morning and that was your prayer? Oh no. Yeah. There's a problem from the night before. There's a problem from yesterday. You wake up and it's still there. You're like, oh no, what am I gonna do? And so the servant's like, what are we gonna do? Verse 16, look at Elisha, super spiritual. Don't be afraid, the prophet answered. Don't be afraid. You guys got that friend of yours that's super spiritual? They always on the spiritual side. You trying to tell them a situation that you're going through. You looking for someone to, you know, feel what you're going through. And they're just like, don't be afraid. Have faith. So the servant's like, oh no, what we're going to do? We're surrounded. He says, don't be afraid. Fear not. Don't be afraid. Look what it goes on to say. He goes, those who are with us are more than those who are with them. Now, I don't know what he's seeing. I can imagine the servant saying, my brother, do you know how to count? One, two, and hundreds, possibly thousands around the city. One, two, and many. Can I just tell you this, that Elisha had an eye to see what others couldn't see? Remember, he was able to see where the enemy was setting up camp. He had vision. He was able to see past what others couldn't see. That's also my prayer, that we would be able to see past what others are not seeing. He says, those who are with us are more than those who are with them. And Elisha prayed, look at this, verse 17. Open his eyes, Lord, so that he may see. The man was already awake. He woke up in the morning. So what eyes was he praying for to be opened? His spiritual eyes. Would your spiritual eyes be open today? Would you not be so afraid by what you see with the natural eye and be able to see beyond what's presently in front of you so that you can see what God is doing around you? And Elisha prayed, open his eyes, Lord, so that he may see. Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes and he looked and saw. Listen, he saw the what? The hills full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. Let's give it up for God's word. When his eyes were opened, he saw from the hills chariots of fire surrounding himself and Elijah. Today I want to speak to you and tell this to the person next to you as you sit down. Beyond the present, beyond the present. You guys may be seated, beyond the present. Thank you, TDP worship team. You guys are awesome. Let's give it up for our worship team that comes before us every week to provide a worship experience for us to encounter God's presence. Beyond the present, that's the subject for today, beyond the present. I want to start out with a story. I work at a hotel also. Pastor on weekends, front desk agent by weekday, chaplain part-time somewhere else. But at the hotel where I work, you know, I hear all kinds of stories, you know, you hear all kinds of things. Let me tell you, you guys as guests, you guys are crazy. I'm just letting you know right now. This hotel experience has changed my life, we'll say. But I hear all kinds of stories, with dealing with guests. And this was actually almost a year ago. I interact with the guests, and there was actually a guest coming in. She comes back late night, and she comes in through the front desk with her son, and I could see that they have their theme park themed items, hats and bags and all that good stuff. So as she was coming by, I stopped and said, "Oh, did you have a good time at the park?" I'm not going to mention the parks. There's several of them here. I don't want to mention any names. We promote too many people in this church already. And so I said, "So how was it? You know, you guys had fun. They looked like they had a great time." I mean, she came in through the door. She was smiling. Her little boy, probably like maybe 4, 5, 6, you know, was smiling. And so I said, "So how was it?" And she then pauses, stops, looks to me. She says, "Well, it was almost a nightmare." She goes, but we had a great time. And I said, "Oh, did something happen?" She's like, "Yeah, something did happen." And so she goes on to tell me this story about how her and her boy, they went into one of the rides that are more like where you kind of sit down in the ride. And it's like a 3D animated ride. You guys ever been in those kinds where they kind of move you around in all these crazy angles? It makes you feel like you went 10 miles somewhere. Made it feel like you flew up to the skies and landed back on Earth. And what's funny, though, is if you don't realize when they turn the lights on, you really didn't go nowhere. You stood in the same room. How many people were amazed by that? Once the lights went on, you're like, "Oh, we really didn't go nowhere." But it's the way how the 3D screen moves and how they tilt the machine at all these certain angles that it makes you feel like you're in motion, that you went to space or something. So she tells me that she was on that ride with that kid. And, you know, when you go on those rides, you got to buckle yourself up and they make sure. And so she says the ride started and the 3D was going on and the light effects and everyone's yelling and screaming and oohs and ahs. And she turns to the side and guess what? Her kid's not in the seat no more. Isn't that like your parent? Isn't that like a parent's worst nightmare? Yes. So she's telling me this story. I'm like, "Oh yes, this almost did end in a nightmare, but apparently your kid's here, so it didn't." So she looks and her kid's not in the seat no more. She didn't notice that while all of that was going on, her kid unbuckled himself and ran off the thing. So she gets up and she starts like screaming, "Help! Help! My son! My son!" So, of course, eventually one of the people who, what do you call those people? Ride attendants. There we go. That's the word. One of the ride attendants, of course, notices. So then they actually end up stopping the ride. The ride has to stop. They stop the ride midway through, lights go on. And so she's like, "My kid, he's not here no more." So as soon as the lights go on, she realizes that she's in the same room. She felt like she went to space too and lost a kid. But she realizes that she didn't lose her kid in space. She actually just lost him in the room. And so when the lights go on, there's actually like 5 ride attendants in that same small room. And the kid is actually standing next to them, holding the hand. And so, of course, she ends up getting to her kid and all this kind of stuff like that. And, you know, it's like a parent's nightmare. Like, where did my kid go? I'm thinking of my granddaughter, you know, like, oh, my God. That could have been a nightmare. So, but she tells me this, and I always remember this. She tells me, she goes, I was terrified. This was a nightmare for me. She goes, but he was actually more safe and more protected than I thought. Once the lights went on, obviously. Not in the dark, not when all that chaos was going on, not with all the commotion. But she said he was actually a lot safer than I thought. Once she realized that, you know, lights go down, show goes down, lights come on, and there's 5 people in the room that you don't notice. You don't realize all the people that are already in there watching out for things like that. So the kid was holding the parents, the ride attendant was with the kid, probably just waiting for the ride to end. And after the mother finished having a great time, be like, oh, where's my kid? Oh, there he is. They're holding him at the door for you. And so I want to use that to say that I think it's a good story to tell us that we're actually more protected than we actually know. Yeah. I just want to use the story to make a connection somewhere. I thought it was a crazy story. I might as well share it somewhere. But that's what she said. She said he was actually more protected. He was actually more safe than I actually thought. She thought it was the end of the world. He's in space somewhere. And today I want to use that kind of as an introduction to set the foundation that we're actually more protected than we realize at times. That God indeed is our fortress. God indeed is our shelter. I mean, when times in your life get dark like that and get rocky and shaky, we usually don't see that there is a fortress, there is a God that is protecting us. So you gotta be able to see beyond that, see beyond the lights, beyond the shaking, beyond all the 3D images that the enemy will put in front of you to put fear inside of you and for you to lose trust in God. But today I wanna tell you that God indeed has protected you. Now I know everyone here be like, well, you don't know me. You don't know the things that I've gone through. You don't know some of the things that I'm going through. Yes, that is true. But can I tell you this? If you're still sitting here and you have breath in your lungs, that means that God has. He already has surrounded you. He already has protected you. He has already been a shelter to you. You just got to be able to see beyond the present darkness that's there. Now, I want to read another passage of scripture that comes into the New Testament in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. And I want to kind of bring a connection to this New Testament scripture. And I want to connect it back to the 2 Kings 6 with Elisha and the servant. You normally wouldn't connect these two or see them connected, but I believe there's a great connection in them. Now, at the same time that I told you that Elisha was a man that was able to, he had a spiritual eye to see. His eyes were open to a spiritual realm. His eyes were open to see on the side of faith that many of us don't walk in. The Bible tells us that we walk by faith and not by sight. Let me tell you this, if you only walked by what you saw in the natural, it would not allow you to step into faith and into the things that God has called us really to step into. You will never meet our purposes in God. You'll never reach your full potential in Christ if you only walk by what you see that is presently in front of you. You have to be able to see beyond that. You have to be able to open your eyes again, not to the natural, but to the spiritual, so that you can see God's protection. And once you see God's protection, you'll be brave. You'll be bold. You'll be courageous. You'll step in places that others will turn away from. Why? Because you're not just looking at what's in front of you. You are seeing God that's beyond that. And therefore, you'll move in faith. You'll act in faith. And this is why Paul tells us and encourages us to walk by faith and not by sight. So part of the series, too, is not just learning about the fortress and the protection that God has over us, but it's to learn to that we live in faith. And for us ever to reach the things that God desires for us, you're gonna have to walk by faith. And that means that the things in front of you aren't gonna always be perfect. They're not always gonna be pleasant. Sometimes situations will get dark on us. Situations will get ugly on us. Sometimes things, you know what, there'll be barriers and there'll be, you know, people telling you that you can't do this, and a situation that tells you, no, 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 you can't do that. But that's why you got to be able to see into the spirit. You got to be able to learn to open your spiritual eye. And it's something that you just pray for. You just begin to pray, God, help me to see beyond what's in front of me. Some say, well, how do I start to do that? One, it starts with Christ being invited into your life. And once you invite Christ into your life, you are born again in the spirit. And therefore, now you have access to see things that you didn't see before. So once Christ comes inside of you, as you invite him in, your spiritual eyes can then be open. And so Paul, too, just like Elisha, was a man that was able to see in this spirit. He's the one who wrote, we walk by faith, not by sight. So 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 6 reads, I want to read a passage of scripture. Paul also could be one of those spiritual friends, man. They're just that much more spiritual than you are. They see things that you can't see. I mean, sometimes you talk to someone, you know, and I'm not going to lie to you. This church started because I saw a vision, not because I saw visions every day. Some of you guys probably see more visions than I have ever seen. You know, we always got someone that just sees more, has a deeper revelation of God. There's someone that will read a verse and be like, wow, and you're looking at that verse confused. It's like, you shouting amen, you still don't understand what the verse means after they explained it. You're just like, hallelujah, praise the Lord, it's good. I receive it in my spirit. And so Paul could have been that friend that just always seen the revelations and always saw beyond what was in front of him. Not me. I'm praying that God will open my eyes too. So can we pray that together, that God will open our eyes? So look at this. Look what Paul writes in, starting at verse 6. He goes, even if I should choose to boast, I would not be a fool because I would be speaking the truth. He's saying if I wanted to boast, I actually could. I wouldn't be a fool. I wouldn't be lying if I wanted to boast. He goes, I'll be speaking the truth. Look what he goes on to say. He goes, but I refrain so no one will think of me more than is warranted by what I do or say, verse 7, or because of these surpassingly great revelations. If you actually read some of the verses right above, Paul's actually talking about all these great revelations that he's seen. He talks about God taking him to different places, places unspeakable, unimaginable. He's writing in this letter saying he's seen things that people haven't seen. God's revealed to him things that others haven't seen. So that's why he goes on to say, if I wanted to boast, I could because of the great revelations that I have seen. But I'm not going to do that because I don't want anyone to think of me more than I really am. He's saying also saying just because I've seen great things doesn't make me better than anyone else. But he says, I could boast a little if I wanted to, but I won't. I think that's boasting already. So, but I'm glad because he's at least truthful. Because look what the next, look how the verse ends. He goes, therefore, in order to keep me from becoming what? Conceited. He goes, I was given a thorn in my flesh. Ooh. A thorn in the flesh. You ever felt you had a thorn in your flesh? Yeah. Thorn in the flesh. Here, we'll read so you can see what this thorn is. Basically a descriptive of what this thorn is, not what the actual thorn is. We never find that out. He was a messenger of Satan. He goes, a messenger of Satan to torment me. He goes, verse 8, three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me. Three times, not once, not twice. Basically, I begged over and over and over again for God to remove this thorn, for God to remove this pain, for God to remove this struggle, for God to remove this enemy, this messenger of Satan to torment me. I pray for God to remove it. So what do you think the next verse is going to say? God removed it? How many people would like it to say that? Okay. How many of you prayed and your expectation that was that it was going to be removed? Yep, all of us. We all know what the verse says. But our expectation is not what the truth of this is. So it's crazy how we will know the truth of this, but we'll expect something else in our lives. Because I prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed for God to remove it. But let's keep going on. He goes, but he said to me, so he prayed to God, look what God says to him. My grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. He's telling him, you actually really see how powerful I am as it is revealed through your weakness. Watch this. So look at this. Look what he says, Paul says. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses. He goes, I'm not going to boast gladly about the revelations that I've seen. I boast actually about the weaknesses that I have. Look at this. So that Christ's power may rest on me. Verse 10, and we'll end there. He goes, that is why for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses. He's saying I embrace them in insults, in hardships. I mean, how many of you us embrace those moments? No, we rebuke them. Don't raise your hand and lie and say, yeah, I embrace them. Thorns, Lord, I embrace. More thorns and thorns and thorns, Lord, that your power may rest on me. No, we don't. But Paul says, I delight in the weakness. I embrace the weakness. I embrace the insult. I embrace the hardship. I embrace the persecution. I embrace the difficulties. Look at this. For when I am weak, then I am strong. I believe also what Paul is saying this, because I believe Paul was able to see as Elisha saw. I believe what Paul was also saying is, yes, the weakness might be in front of him, but just beyond that is the strength of the Lord. And today I want to tell you that. I know how some of you guys feel. You're like, well, I ain't having no revelations. I ain't never going to have a revelation. I ain't never going to have a vision. God ain't never going to use me. I'm never going to be a great person. I'm never going to be a great man. I'm never going to be a great woman. Because why? All this struggle that's in front of me. I believe what Paul was trying to tell us is, you got to see past that. And I want to tell you something that helped me a lot. That weakness might not ever go away. I know you're praying for it, and I know you're fasting 2 times a month for it, but the struggle might not ever go away. You might always feel that struggle. You might always feel that pain. But what happened, God? You're supposed to deliver me. I prayed 3 times, Paul said, and God just said, my grace is sufficient. In other words, you might go to the grave with the struggle, but God has a supply of strength to help you with the struggle as you go to the grave. So you might go down with it, but God's strength and his supply will be there with you through that struggle. Oh, this delivered me. Because I was growing up, and where I grew up, I remember they would just say, you need deliverance, just come in the front, and we would pray, and you know what? I got delivered from one thing, and then I walked away, and I still had something else. And I was like, oh my God. Oh no, I'm broken still. I ain't never going to see a revelation now like the man who prayed for me. I'm never going to see a vision. My spiritual eyes are never going to open. Why? Because I still felt a struggle. And then when I realized that Paul said, I'm going to the grave with this struggle, but God has a supply of his strength to help me with the struggle. You might go to the grave fighting that thing, but you know what? Fight it. Amen. Can I just tell you that? Just fight that thing. You might fight it, chase it off. It'll leave you for 3 months, and then all of a sudden it'll start to pop its head and its horns out at you again to torment you. But you know what? Fight it then and say, you know what, God? You got a strength for me. You got an endless supply of your strength. And you know, you're going to help me through this struggle. And you know what? I might have to pray a little bit more during this season. I might have to fast a little bit more. I might have to worship a little harder. But I know you got an endless supply of your strength to help me get through this sucker right here. Yeah. I know some of us, we look at Elisha's and we look at Paul's and you look at pastors and you say, man, I can't wait to be them. They always talking about their revelations. They always seeing beyond what's in front of them. They always have this faith and this vision to see great things. I don't see nothing. I see the enemy's horsemen all around. I see my weakness all around. I see my struggle all around. That's why Paul said, I'm weak, but then I'm strong. Then comes after. Then comes beyond. You gotta see through the weakness to find God's strength. So can I also tell you this? You can't stop at the weakness. Don't give up because you got a weakness. Don't stop believing because you got a weakness. Don't stop going to church because you slipped up in the middle of the week and now you feel like, oh, God, you know, this ain't really working. No, you might go to the grave with the weakness. What you have to do is learn to find God's strength in that weakness. So pretty much this is what we do naturally. The minute when we slip up, we want to pull back. No, that's when you got to draw in closer. So when you're going through a struggle, don't say, oh, no, that's it. This ain't really working. I gave my life to God and I got baptized. And, oh, there I go. I made a mistake again. Oh, this ain't really working. You know, I can't go back. I can't face all of that. Oh, I'm not real. I'm a hypocrite. No, that's the enemy's voices trying to get you to stop at the weakness. But there's strength beyond that weakness if you hold in the fight. And let me tell you this. You might have a weakness. You might have a struggle. Doesn't mean you won't ever see a vision or a revelation from God. That's right. The revelations that God wants to give to you and the promises that he has for you and the gifts that he's placed inside of you and the potential, it's not limited by your weakness. That's why Christ went to the cross. He's already crucified your weakness on the cross. Now he just needs to work in your life through it so you can still behold the beauty of what he wants to do in you. The vision of this church, I didn't see it because I was perfect. That'd be a lie. I mean, it'd be a good story. I can try to boast in that, but I really can only tell you about my weaknesses, that I'm just like you and I have struggles just like you and I get sick like you. Pastors and leaders are invincible. I have the flu, so don't get too close to me. But I'm seeing God's strength through it. So that's why you don't stop. I could have easily said, I'm not going to come today. We got four other preachers lined up for this series. We'll just call one of them in a day early. But I'm seeing God's strength through the weakness, beyond what's presently in front of me. So can you do that too? Amen. So now I want to go back into Kings. Today I just got three things for you, not 3 points, but three things that I want us to see through the text that we read. So we began at verse 15, right? 2 Kings 6:15. I just want to go up two verses to verse 13. It's going to be there for them. Just go right forward. And so remember, this enemy army was really, his intention was to take out Israel and the king, right? But because Elisha was able to see his plans and where he was positioning his men, his chariots and his fighting men, Elisha was able then to tell the king of Israel, and then the king of Israel would be careful not to go that way and not fall into the plans and the traps of the enemy. And so then the king, his great plan, the enemy king, is to, well, let's take out Elisha, and then eventually we could then take out the army of God. So look at what verse 13 says. Go find out where he is. This is the words of the enemy king. He says, go find out where he is, the king ordered, so I can send men and capture him. The report came back, he is in Dotham. Now they know where he's at. Not Gotham City, he's in Dotham. Verse 14 goes on to say, then he sent horses and chariots and a strong force there. They went by night and surrounded the city. The enemy always comes by night. He always comes in deception. He always comes. It's like the lady, that woman with her son, of course, she lost her son in the night almost, in the darkness. And the enemy always comes. He always comes. He always comes at the night of our lives many times. He knows how to plan it out. You know, while you're sleeping, he's planning. That's what that means. While you're resting and you're snoring and you're having visions and dreams of the good things that God wants to do with you, he's already planning an attack. He's already planning to come after you. And so I want to tell you this, that the enemy comes after us to kill the potential that's inside of us. The main reason why he's after Elisha, one is the real reason why he wants to take Elisha out is because he wants to take out the gift that God's given him. He's able to see. He's able to know the plans. He has a vision to see beyond what's presently in front of him. So he's really after the gift that's inside of him. He could care less if his name is Elisha or Elijah. He just wants to take out his ability. And the servant's just caught in the crossfire here. Excuse me, I know how some of you feel, but I want to tell you this, that the enemy will go after you because of what's inside of you. Why does he come at night? Because he knows what's inside of you. And I know how some of you feel, and I felt like this many times. Well, I ain't having no visions. I ain't prophesying. You know, what does the enemy want to do with me? I ain't doing nothing in the church. I go every Sunday every now and then, you know. But why would he be coming after me? Today I want to tell you this, that the enemy, he exists in the spiritual realm. See, right, Elijah, we read that he prays for the servant's eyes to be open so that he can see in the spirit what God is doing. But I want to tell you that in that spiritual realm, that is where the enemy also exists. The enemy exists in the spiritual realm. And many times we can't see what God is doing in the spiritual realm, but because the enemy exists in the spiritual realm, that's where the enemy also sees. So check this out. The enemy can see potential in us that's in the spiritual realm that we can't see ourselves. So basically, the enemy can see an anointing that's around us, even though we don't see it. The enemy can see that God, from when we're born, has great significance and purpose with us. He can see that in the spirit. Our promises, our potential, and our purpose is all really in the spiritual, just ready to be birthed out and manifested in our lives. Here, let me read a verse to show you that, so you don't think I'm just making that stuff up. But our promises, our purposes, our potential are kept in the supernatural heavenly realm. And so the enemy who exists in that same realm sees that. So he'll attack us for stuff that hasn't even come out yet. He'll go after us. That's why he gave you all that trouble while you were growing up. And like, you know, why I'm going through all of this? Because he knew the potential that was inside of you that you were born with. And even right now in your life, you might thinking you're not doing anything so significant. But he sees that same anointing that God placed over your life when you were created. And he sees it building up. And he sees that God's getting ready to use you within his kingdom. And so you know what? He goes after you at night. He's coming after you now. Check this out. Ephesians 1. Look what Paul writes in Ephesians 1 verse 3. He says, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us where? In the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Our spiritual blessings exist in the spiritual realm. And let me tell you this, when God even gives us gifts, he doesn't give them all to us at one time. He has blessings stored up for us. He has promises stored up in heavenly realms. And as you grow in him, as you walk in faith towards him, those promises will be released over your life. Certain potentials will come out of you at different times. In stages you will grow, with purpose will become more clear. Promises will come down. Potential will come out. But they're all in the heavenly realm. So this is why you got chariots surrounding you now. See, Elisha probably clearly knows. He ain't afraid. He can see there already, but think about the servant. He's like, who am I? I'm not having prophetic dreams. I'm not able to see things. But the servant too has a purpose. And so for the person in here, you're wondering what's all this confrontation in your life and why your life is like a crazy merry-go-round of fight after fight, struggle after struggle, one wrong thing going wrong after the other wrong thing. I tell you right now, I'm almost certain it's the enemy trying to stop the potential that is unbirthed. So, here's another thing. The servant is in trouble. The servant wakes up in the morning, he's like, well, oh no. Servant's in trouble, right? They really want Elisha, but the servant is caught in the crossfire. How many of you heard the saying? I believe it goes, let's see if I even know it, but it's, tell me who your friends are, and I'll tell you who you are. Or is it, tell me who you walk with, and I'll tell you who you are? Something like that, right? We know. We get the point. Usually it's in a negative connotation that we embrace that, right? You know, if your friends are doing foolish things, if they got foolish actions and foolish attitudes and foolish auras about themselves, you know, show me those people, and I know that that'll rub off on you, right? And so if they're doing something foolish, their actions are foolish. They got foolish actions. In turn, you know, you might be caught in that crossfire of their mess. They're doing something wrong and you're just hanging out with them. Then what happens? You get caught in that crossfire. And now their foolish aura and their foolish actions are rubbing off on you. How many people have been there? You wasn't the bad one, but you walked with someone who was the bad one. And all of their stuff spilled over on you. Well, let me tell you that that doesn't just work in the bad. That also works in the good, too. You walk with a man of God, and that anointing is going to also follow you. They got foolish actions. If you're walking with someone who has a fresh anointing, that's going to get on you too. And so let me tell you, you'll get in the crossfire of that too. There's crossfire not just for the bad aura, but there's also, you know, you get caught in crossfire that you get problems because someone's got a fresh anointing. And that's what Elisha had. He had a fresh anointing. He received a double portion of the prophet Elisha. Elisha had a great anointing over his Elijah had a great anointing over his life, and when he was getting ready to be taken up by God, he didn't even die. And the prophet Elisha, who was like his disciple, was like, I don't want to leave you. I don't want to leave you. And then Elijah tells him, he said, when I get taken up, if you can see me, then you can get that double portion that you're asking for. But that's no easy thing. And the Bible says that chariots of fire came and they lifted up Elijah. And then Elisha said, he called them, my Lord, my Lord. I see. He was gifted with this vision that he can always see. He said, I see the chariots. He could always see what God was doing. And he grabbed onto Elijah's mantle, his cloak, and it ripped in two, and he stood with half of it. And so he was anointed. He had a fresh anointing. God, up until chapter 6, he's just beginning his ministry. He asked for a double portion. I was reading this. This is cool. I read that if you put in, if you try to add up Elijah, the first one, you add up his miracles, prophecies, and visions, there's 14. That blows out much of anyone else's, resume of prophets, just that alone. Now, Elisha asked for a double portion. Now, if you look at Elisha's life and when the time he ended, I read that he did 28. The double portion that he asked for was a double portion that he received. That's just awesome. I don't know how it relates to the sermon, but it's just cool. It's a cool fact. I just thought that was cool. I want to throw it out there. But basically what I'm saying is this, that now Elisha's servant is in the middle of the crossfire. And you know what? You stand next to someone who's anointed, and the enemy will come after you too. Yet some of you guys are in trouble because of who you're with. So I would advise some of you, be careful if you really want to be my friend. To tell the person next to you, I'm anointed. Be careful if you want to be my friend. And if you think I'm cute and you want to ask me out on a date, tell them, be careful because I'm anointed. You might get in the crossfire of my anointing. Do you really want to be my friend? I'm anointed. David said, your anointing is my head with oil, my cup, what? It runneth over. His anointing spilled onto his children and onto those around him. And so you know what? Some of you kids, you're wondering why you're going through some of the stuff. It's because your parents are anointed. And what God has given them is now pouring into your life. And it hasn't come to life yet. But that's why the enemy's coming after you. Because, you're standing next to someone anointed. I would even dare say that some of you are going through the stuff that you're going through. Is because you're sitting in an anointed place. You're sitting in a place that God wants to do something great. We're in the middle of God doing something great in our city. And I know there's a fresh anointing in this place. And just by you coming here, just by you feeling part of what God wants to do here, just by you signing up to be a C group and signing up to be a volunteer, you know what? You might get a little bit in that crossfire, but I'm going to tell you that if you open your eyes, you're going to see that there's more that are for us than against us. And God's spirit is always mightier. God's presence is always stronger. So some of the fight that you're in right now is just because you're standing next to something that's anointed. Amen. I like standing next to you. Your anointing rubs off on me. That's why we have fellowship. That's why we have communion. So what God put inside of us could pour out onto others. You look at someone and say, ooh, they're not as anointed as me. I don't want to be their friend. That's what you need to do. Sit with them and be their friend. And let the anointing that you got and the spirit of what God is doing pour into their lives. It's how we change. We're big on sitting down and breaking bread together and fellowshipping. God does something there. Please don't run out the church door the minute service is over if you have a chance to sit down and talk with someone. We see God through each other. Believe that with all my life. All right, let me finish this so I can get to these three things. Don't worry, they'll be quick. We're going to get moving right now. So we just read what? We read Ephesians. So let's get back to the text where we originally began reading so we could finish this thing. When the servant of the man of God got up and went out early the next morning, an army with horses and chariots had surrounded the city. Surrounded the city. So look at his prayer. Oh no, my Lord, what shall we do? The servant asked. Elisha responds in verse 16, don't be afraid. The prophet answered, those who are with us are more than those who are with them. And this is the first thing I want to tell you. You need to know the advantage. Number one, know the advantage. And I want you to write that down. And right next to it, just write 2 Kings 6, verse 16. I want you to know that. I want you to know the advantage. What is the advantage? The advantage is always on our side. Always. When we are in Christ, let me tell you this, God is always bigger than the enemy, and he always will be. His spirit will always be stronger than the enemy's stronghold. God's purposes will always be greater than the enemy's plans for us. The advantage is always ours. It doesn't matter how it looks. It doesn't matter what you wake up to in the morning. It doesn't matter how your body feels. It doesn't matter the report that the doctors give you. It doesn't matter if the business isn't doing so well. It doesn't matter if you're feeling that you heard some word that they might be letting you go. Let me tell you, it doesn't matter how it looks. The advantage is always ours in Christ. Why? Because there are always more that are for us than against us. One, all we need is God. But it's awesome to know that God also has his angels out there looking after us too. So the advantage is always ours. That's what you got to know. It reminds me of this verse in the New Testament, 1 John 4. I'll read it to you. Look, it'll be right there. You are of God, little children, and have overcome them. You've overcome the world. You have overcome. God has given us power to overcome struggles, weaknesses, temptation, things of the world. Look, because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the what? In the world. Don't you see the connection of those two verses there? Elisha said, there are more that are for us than those against us. And look what this verse is saying right here. Greater is he that is in you, meaning God, Christ Jesus, than he that is in the world. Some of you feel in the disadvantage. You always feel you're behind. You always feel that you're less than. One decision puts you at the advantage. That's opening up your heart to Jesus Christ. And the minute that you say yes to him, and the minute that you allow him in, you are in the advantage. And this is good for the people that are already in the Lord, because we'd be dragging ourselves around like we're defeated. We're dragging ourselves around like we're losing. No, you're not losing. You're not ever, ever losing. You're just looking at the wrong thing. You're looking at the chariots that are in front of you, and you're missing to see the angels at the hills that are surrounding. We fail to see the protection. I realized this. I do really good every morning. I do really good at asking God to protect me. How many of you guys do really good at that? It's like every morning. You never forget that. You never forget, God, protect me. It almost comes out like, God, you better protect me today. I do really good at demanding God to protect me, and I do poorly at acknowledging the protection that he has already given me. I mean, there's so many things that we could pray about. I could pray about my character. I could pray about my attitude. I forget to pray about my struggles sometimes, and that's probably why I keep falling into it. Anyone, amen over here? I never forget, protect me, God. But I want to tell you this, that God is always, 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 always. He'll never slip his mind. He'll never forget. God will always and is always protecting you. Amen. It's why you're here today. He's been a fortress. So we're asking God to protect us like if he's forgotten. Or he's going to forget. Let me tell you this. God knows our purpose and is fully aware more than we ourselves. And I'm not telling you that praying for yourself or praying for your children is bad. But for how much we ask him to protect us and how much we actually give him praise and acknowledgement for protecting us, I don't think we do a good job. It's like we prayed all week for God to protect us, and we woke up every single morning and went to bed every single night, and we come into a church and it's like, oh, they're singing again? They're going to keep singing? When's that song going to be over? When that guy's going to be, shut up. I think this is the perfect place to acknowledge that God has protected us. I don't feel good. My throat is terrible right now. But I worshiped God through that weakness. And I'm not doing that to boast. Too late, right? Nah, I see what Paul was doing. But I say that so that we gotta do it beyond what's in front of us. Amen. Yeah, the throat hurts. That's present. But beyond that is God's strength. And, you know, I gotta pray so that I can acknowledge for what he's done in my life. And so always know that the advantage is always ours. God always is thinking protection first. Because if he doesn't protect us, then we can't reach the potential. So don't worry. God's not going to forget you one morning. But take advantage to pray for other things so you can get to your potential faster, as God is already protecting you. Amen? Amen. So that's number one. And now, verse 17. It says, and Elisha prayed, open his eyes. Why? Because his physical eyes were open, but his spiritual eyes weren't seeing. Elijah was already seeing something that this servant wasn't seeing. He says, open his eyes, Lord, so that he may see. Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he looked and saw the hills full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. Here's the next thing you got to do. Open my eyes. Write that down. Open my eyes. Open my eyes. If you would open your eyes, you would see the protection. I need 4 angels. I told you guys were going to help me preach. I need 4 angels, and I need 4 female angels. I don't know if they exist in heaven, but we're going to have them down here for today. Don't worry, I'm going to use gentlemen later on. I need 4, just 4 angels. Just raise your hand if you want to be an angel. Raise your hand, lady. There's 1, there's 2, there's 3, and 4. Right over there, those 4. Come. Those 4 over there. Come. You were number 1, 2, 3, or 4. I got 4 angels. You guys are going to help me preach this. Awesome. Hey, cameraman, you're going to have to get ready for this. I'm about to mess up our shot. Cameraman, coming down here with these 4 angels. They ready? Okay. Sound guy, be ready in case we get crazy feedback here. Open my eyes. Angels. So let's read this. My angels, come forward for a minute, my angels. Just step right here, It says, and Elisha prayed, open his eyes, Lord, so that he may see. Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he looked and saw the hills full of horses, chariots of fire, all around Elisha. And so this is awesome. So what I need you to do is, you're going to make a circle around me, but you're not going to face me. You're going to face outward. Okay. There we go. I think we might need one more angel. Can we get another angel? Just here, you're going to actually face outward. Hold each other's hands, angels. There you go. I need one more angel to fill this circle. Right there, hold her hand. There you go. You're making a circle, so there you go. Hold her hand. And then can you guys connect? Awesome. There, good. I'm in the circle. So he prayed. He said, Lord, I'm going to pray that this servant's eyes may be open. And it says that when the servant opened the eyes, it said that he saw chariots. He saw angels. It says he looked and saw the hills full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elijah. It just made me think too that's exactly what Elisha saw too when Elijah was being taken up. He always saw these horses. He's always saw God's fortress. He always saw God's protection. So so it's cool to think to know that from that point, from when Elijah was taken up, even till now, he's never stopped seeing them. Elisha has always seen them. Elisha has been walking his whole life like this. Seeing chariots, seeing horses, seeing God's protection. Today, we're seeing angels around. And so the funny thing and the cool thing is this, that when he prayed for the eyes to be open and the servant's eyes were open, he didn't send the chariots then. They were already there. He was just able to see it. And so this is what I want to pray. That's why I said in the beginning of the sermon, I want to pray that our eyes would be open to see that this is how we live. That this is how we live, that God is a fortress. And it's not, sometimes we're praying like, God, you got to protect me. God, you better protect me today. God, send them today. No, we're living like this. From the moment you were born, God set a hedge. God set a hedge of protection. He God set a refuge. And so you know what? Doesn't matter if you go this way, there he is. If you go this way, there he is. If you go this way, there he is. If life is taking you this way, that protection is all around you. That's why you're here today. Everything you've gone through is because of this. He's been a mighty fortress. He's always been there. Elisha, once he saw those chariots, he never stopped seeing them. So that's why when the enemy got close, he didn't get scared. That's why he told them, there are more that are for us, my bro, than those that are against us. Because why? He was always seeing them. His eyes were always open. Today I want to tell you, know that there's a circle, there's a fortress of God that is around you. How good does that feel now to know that what you can see right here physically, oh, it's even that much greater spiritually if you would open your eyes. How many people can say amen? And that's why when Yeshua went crazy, you didn't go crazy. And that's why when you thought about committing suicide, some crazy kind of way you didn't, because this fortress, these chariots, these angels were always around you protecting you. That's why it didn't matter that you were in drugs and looked like the drugs were going to take you out. But here you are today, standing in a church, because this was always there. Amen. Always there. Isn't it awesome to know? So check this out. Hey, my angels. I want to go. Keep holding hands. Keep holding hands. You got to be my fortress. Don't let go. So if God wants to take me that way in life, all right, we're going to shuffle to the right. Let's shuffle. There we go. Guess what? His fortress is there. If God wants to take me this direction now, let's shuffle that back that way, ladies. He's there. He's always there. Now, this is awesome. Right? This is awesome. This feels good. I would love to preach like this every Sunday. You guys up for that? Yeah? Hey, help me preach every Sunday? Nah. Now, this is awesome. Now, I need about 6 guys to be some enemy forces.
Yeah.
Come on. Come on. All right, let's move that way. All right, guys, we're going to shuffle back. Shuffle back a little bit. Give room for the enemy to try. Right there. You guys, just come in front. You can do a half circle. Do a half circle. You guys hold hands now and do a half circle. I tell you we was all going to preach today. Hold hands. All right, we need one more. One more enemy. One more. One more. There we go. See? So they represent the enemy. They represent the fortress of God. And so this is our prayer, right? God, never let one of these things get through this fortress. And God has protected you through struggles, through your weaknesses, through a loved one, through a report of a sickness, through suicide, the angels have protected you. Now, this is awesome, this picture right here. But this is not what the text says. Yeah. I was like, oh, this is awesome, God. This is awesome. You know, you're never going to let nothing happen to me. It preaches nice, but then all of you guys know that you got sick. You lost a loved one. You know, you got fired from the job. Your kid walked out on you. That stuff touched you. So they actually have, this is what we feel. We feel that they've broken through. All right, now I'm going to ask some of you guys to just break through their barrier and step in. Step in. Right here. Boom. Now, boom. Look like they're chasing out the fortress. All right, you guys can spread out. Boom. Spread out. Coming closer. See, and when we look at our lives, this is how we really feel. Like, God, well, if you were going to be a fortress, then I would have never got sick. God, if you were going to be a fortress, I would have never lost my job. God, if you would have been a fortress, I would not be out in the streets right now. God, if you would have been a fortress to me, I would not. So check this out. We got to look at this text together. Don't worry. We're going to bring our circles back. It's going to make sense. So if we actually go to verse 15... Go to verse 15, my brother. You don't have to go back for that. Verse 15. It says, when the servant of the man of God got up and went out early the next morning, an army with horses and chariots had surrounded the city. So pretty much we know that the servant and Elijah and Dotham, the city, and it says that now the city has been surrounded by enemy horsemen, chariots. And so this is what the servant was seeing. He's seeing what's right in front of him. And so we would love for the picture to be that the angels were positioned in such a way and God's protection, his fortress would be around us in so much that this stuff wouldn't happen to us and I wouldn't be touched and I wouldn't go through this experience and I wouldn't have this loss. That's how we want it to be. And the minute that something touches us that we don't want to be touched by, then we start to question if God's really protecting us, right? We then start to not trust him. We don't thank him as much because we're like, well, you know what, God, if you were really protecting me, then I wouldn't have gotten this sickness. This wouldn't have touched my life. But check this out. The army is surrounding the city, and the city is surrounding Elisha and the prophet. Now let's keep reading. Go now to 16. Don't be afraid, the prophet answered. Those who are with us are more than those who are with them. Go now to verse 17. And Elisha prayed, open his eyes, Lord, so that he may see. Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he looked and saw what? The hills full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. So check this out. We had the picture wrong the whole time. You gentlemen now make a circle around me. Make a circle around me. Make a circle. Tight circle around me. Tight circle around me. Tight circle around me. Very tight. Get as tight as you can. Very, very, very tight. Elisha and the servant are in the city. Pretty tight. Almost too tight, my brother. But it's all good. This is how we feel in life. The struggle's too tight. We'll take it today, guys. So Elisha and the servant are in the city, and they're surrounding the city. When he prays for the servant's eyes to be open, his eyes are open, and where does he see God's chariots? In the hills. The hills are actually surrounding the city. Now, I need you girls to make, come on, my angels, start making your circle, and I'm going to need a couple of more angels over here to complete this circle. Come on, come on, because you know what? It also said that there are more that are for us than those that are against us. So I want you to see this picture here. We usually like it the other way around, that God's protecting us so much that things don't touch us and things don't get in. But I got some good news for all of you here. Even when it's touching you, whatever the enemy has surrounded you with, God is surrounding the enemy Amen. Himself.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah, yeah, that's good right there. Because you would think that nothing would ever touch you. You would think that nothing would ever get close to you. But let me tell you this, that even when it gets close to you, God is still surrounding you.
Amen. Amen.
So the enemies are around the city, but God's protection is in the hills. That's why you got to look beyond the present. Because if you only look at what's presently in front of you, you're like, God, where are you? Sickness. Thoughts in my head of confusion. Doubt, despair. I wonder if that's why David said, I look to the hills from whence cometh my hope. I wonder if David saw it too. Did David see these same chariots too in his life? And that's why he was always talking about the mighty fortress of God and the refuge of God. If you look beyond what's in front of you and you open your eyes, his fortress has always been there.
Amen.
His fortress has always been there. Yes. And so let me tell you this. When the enemy's got a plan to surround you, no, God's got a greater plan Amen. To yes. surround him.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Even Jesus, when he was on the cross, there in front of everybody, I could imagine. TDP Worship, come help me out. Jesus was there on the cross, and the enemies all around him, the Roman soldiers all around him, the Pharisees all around him, people mocking him, piercing him at his side. He stood there with thorns, his body broken, bleeding, stuck vinegar in his mouth. I could imagine the enemy rejoicing. Why? Because they were surrounding Jesus. Little did he know that God was surrounding the whole situation.
Amen.
Little did he know that God was superimposing his will from the outside. We always want God to protect us from the inside out, but God protects us from the outside in. And so, yeah, the enemy might got a good plan working against you, but God's got something great working for you. And there's always more. There's always more. There's always more. Thank you, guys. You guys may be seated. Thank you for that. Let's give it up for our amazing, beautiful angels and our too close for comfort enemy chariots over here. Even know where, how'd my iPad get all the way over there? How many people could give him praise? Tell your neighbor that he's in the hills. He's in the hills. He's in the hills. So this is the last thing. Last thing I want to tell you, you got to see beyond the present. See beyond the present. Write that down. see beyond the present. Psalm 121, look at it, there it is. David said, I will lift up mine eyes. Where? Onto the hills. From whence cometh what? My help. He'll send his help from the hills. As the enemy approaches you and zero ends on you, don't be afraid. That's what Elisha told the servant. Don't worry, I know they're closing in. I know they surrounded the city, but guess what? God's coming from the hills. His protection's coming from the hills. From whence cometh my help? My help cometh from the Lord, which made the heaven and the earth. I'm gonna invite you all to stand to your feet right now. And I wanna tell you to look beyond the present. Look beyond the present and to the hills. I know some of you guys don't like to be too close and stuff like that, but can you take the person's hand next to you? And I want to do this to symbolize the fortress of God, the strength of God that's protecting us, that's protecting you, and that's also protecting our city. I believe God brought this church to this area for a reason. I believe we're in Kissimmee for a great reason. And I know when you look into our city, you don't see too many good things. I remember when I came over here, I was like, whoa, this is the place you brought me to, God. Can you send me to Orlando or something? I kept seeing what was in front of me. I kept seeing, you know, some of the work that the enemy was doing at the time. But now I know that God's in the hills. He's in the hills. And as we lock hands, as we fortify ourselves, as we strengthen each other with our hands, I want this to be a symbol of what God's really doing in our city right now. How many people believe that God's going to do something great in our city? And you know, we got to look beyond what's happening right now. We got to look beyond the struggle that we see right now in our city. We got to look beyond the weakness of our city. And we got to know that we got a mighty Savior, that we got a God that is for us. And if he's for us, then there's really nothing that can be against us. We got a God that has angels and just has his presence mighty with us. And so as we lock hands, I want it to be a representation. Now I want us to lift up our hands as a symbol of God's presence in the hills of our city right now. And we're going to look beyond what's in front of us. God, right now we pray with hands lifted up, Lord God, as a symbol of your mighty fortress, as a symbol of your protection, as a symbol of your strength. Right now we look past our weakness as individuals. We look past our failures, Lord God. We look past our hurts, Lord God. We look past our sicknesses and our diseases. We look past the job loss. We look past losing the house. We look past losing the car. We look past losing our son or our daughter. We know that your strength, Father, we know that your power, we know that your fortress is just beyond that, just right past that. There you are. So, Father, we stand right now, opening our eyes, seeing in faith. I pray that we would see your chariots right now.